Hey guys, so I am an educator at an academy and you can follow me over there if you're interested to watch videos on basic concepts of chemistry or physical chemistry topics. You can also recommend this to your juniors and to your younger siblings, right? All you need to do is download the an academy learning app and watch my videos over there. Now let's just begin with our topic.
Right, so very good evening to all of you, and today we are going to talk about your Sonogoshira coupling reaction. Like Suzuki coupling, it's a very like versatile reaction. We can use it for a different kind of things, and this coupling reactions are a little different than rest of the reactions. I told you the mechanism is going to be the same, but there's a slight variable that we'll see in this particular reaction, okay, as compared to other coupling reactions. Heck reaction has a totally different mechanism, but it has one extra step as compared to other coupling reactions, and in Sonogoshira something different altogether happens, okay. So if I talk about Sonogoshira reaction, we have an alkyne over here. You can see this is an alkyne, and then we can have a aryl halide or a vinyl halide, okay. This could be a aryl halide or a vinyl halide, like I have mentioned over here, and this X group can be a halogen or it can be a triflate also, okay. Now over here what we are doing is, if you see other kinds of coupling reactions, like we discussed Suzuki reaction, there we were using organo boranes, okay. Then in Hyama coupling we were using organosilanes, okay. In stele coupling we used mercury compounds, okay. But over here we are simply using alkynes. We are not using any kind of carbon silicon bond or a carbon boron bond, something like that. We are not using anything. We are just using simple alkynes. The only thing that we are doing is we are adding, along with the palladium catalyst, this one is also a palladium catalyzed reaction, but we are using copper as well. In this particular reaction, we are using copper as well, and simply this R dash group, which is attached to the X, that is any halogen or triflet, this R dash group gets attached to our R group, and we have a carbon-carbon bond forming reaction. So it's pretty easy, because we don't need any kind of organosilanes or organoboranes. We don't need to synthesize any kind of compounds. We can simply use our alkyne, and we can do the Sonogoshira reaction, and we can get a carbon-carbon bond forming reaction. And the Sonogoshira coupling is very vital in your organic in pharmaceutical industry, and also to make your solar cells. Right now there's a lot of work going on in organic solar cells, and there also there are a lot of researchers using Sonogoshira reaction to carry out to make organic solar cells. Like there's a professor in IIT Indore, I don't know his full name, but it starts with Dr. Rajneesh. So he's also working on organic solar cells, and if you see his research work, he's also working on your carbon-carbon Sonogoshira reactions, okay. Now coming on to the mechanism, so the mechanism is quite simple. Again, the first step is oxidative addition. We have a palladium catalyst, which is in zero oxidation state, which is our active catalyst. Once we add this aryl halide or vinyl halide, we get this palladium bond gets inserted, and the oxidation state changes to +2. So palladium now will be in +2 oxidation state over here, and it gets inserted between this R and X, between this carbon and halogen bond, okay. Now the next step is transmetallation. So there are two mechanisms that are going on simultaneously, okay. So the first mechanism you have to focus over here, just focus over here once, okay. So we have our copper catalyst, okay, which is X is any halogen. Let's say we have copper iodide, okay. So what happens is, this is existing as Cu plus and the halogen minus, okay. So now when we add the alkyne, so what happens is, this copper, it's electron deficient, and this alkyne over here, it's electron rich. So this copper kind of coordinates with this triple bond, between this C triple bond C and copper, there's some kind of a coordination bond that is formed. Now because of this coordination, this hydrogen, this carbon hydrogen bond weakens. So if we add very weak base also, very weak base, like you can say triethylamine. So if we add triethylamine over here, so what happens is, this triethylamine, it abstracts this hydrogen over here, okay. It abstracts this hydrogen. So once this triethylamine abstracts this hydrogen, then this copper, then a negative charge will be generated here, right. Once the hydrogen is abstracted, negative charge will be generated here. So then this copper, which was earlier forming a coordination bond with the triple bond, it moves and it coordinates over here. So because there's a negative charge and copper is electron deficient, copper has positive charge, it's a metal. So these two form a bond, and this is our active form that is required. So this is what copper does. Basically, copper coordinates to this carbon, and the transmetallation step is favored. So now what happens is, basically your X, that is over here, the one in blue, which is attached to the palladium, and the copper, they get exchanged. Okay, so this copper and this X, they leave, and we again get our copper iodide. So this copper iodide is regenerated, and this step is followed. And once this copper iodide is regenerated, this alkyne that we had, this gets attached over here. So you can see this alkyne that we had, to which the copper was attached, it gets attached to the palladium. And this X bond that was attached to the palladium earlier in this oxidative addition step, if you see this particular step in the oxidative addition, the X that was attached, it gets exchanged, and we have a triple bond over here. Then there's something called as a trans cis isomerization that takes place. So the ligands, you can see over here, they get rearrange themselves. Okay, these ligands rearrange themselves. If you focus over here, these ligands have rearranged themselves, and then reductive elimination takes place. That is, this palladium gets removed between these two carbon bonds, and finally we get our alkyne over here. That is a coupled product. So this is the whole catalytic cycle of our Sonogoshira reaction. Now you need to know the reactivity order also, okay? Because sometimes, let's say if a compound has both, let's say iodine and bromine attached, okay? Or let's say iodine and chlorine. So which one will you favor? Or let's say there's a compound which has a triplet and which has a chloride. So where will Sonogoshira reaction be favored? So it depends upon the reactivity, or the reactivity order towards oxidative addition. Okay, so the slow step in the reaction in the whole catalytic cycle is your oxidative addition. So the faster the oxidative addition takes place, the faster the Sonogoshira reaction is going to take place, and that particular product will be more favored. So vinyl iodides undergo oxidative addition fastest, followed by vinyl triplets. Then this is the order basically. So let's say if we have aryl iodine in a compound, let's say there's a compound which has let's say there's benzene, okay? Let's say this is a compound, okay? I'll discuss some examples also, but for the time being, let's say this is our compound, and we have, let's say, iodine attached, and on the ortho position we have a chlorine attached. So which one will be favored? So like I told you, aryl iodines are more reactive as compared to aryl chlorides. So if Sonogoshira reaction has to take place, it will be preferred at the iodine, not at the chlorine. All right, then there are certain limitations that are that are associated with our Sonogoshira reaction. One is that we need to use we are using a metal which is obviously not favored. It's not environmentally friendly. We are using bases, like I told you, triethylamine. So we are using high equivalence of triethylamine, which is again not preferred. And then there's something called as a homocoupling. Homocoupling means two alkynes, they can react together only instead of reacting with some other alkyne. So that is also one major drawback of this particular reaction. Okay, now coming on to copper free reaction. So latest, very recently, there has been a modification in the Sonogoshira reaction. Many people are working towards making it better, and they have actually found a reaction which is copper free. So this is a very big step in improving the efficiency and the overall, you know, overall utility of our Sonogoshira reaction. Now what is the basic mechanism? The mechanism remains somehow the same. If you focus here, I'll just go in brief. First of all, oxidative addition takes place. The palladium gets inserted between your carbon and halogen bond. You can see over here. Now next, what is happening is we have our alkyne. This is our alkyne over here, and the alkyne gets exchanged with a ligand. Okay, so a ligand is removed. So what happens is, basically to the palladium we'll attach a ligand which can be easily removed. So what happens is, this triple bond, it coordinates with the palladium. Instead of coordinating with copper, now this triple bond is coordinating directly with the palladium, because this ligand that we are attaching to the palladium is a very good leaving group. It's a comparatively good leaving group. So it can displace the ligand and can directly attach to the palladium. Okay, then we are adding our base. Okay, once we add the base, what happens is, basically you can see it abstracts this hydrogen. This base will abstract the hydrogen over here, the triple bond hydrogen. It will abstract this hydrogen, and once it abstracts this hydrogen, the ligand which had been removed earlier, the ligand which had been removed in this step, you can see a ligand was removed, that replaces our X. So if you see in this compound, we also have X, right? If you focus on this step, we also have X. So this ligand takes place, you can see the ligand is back on the palladium and the X is displaced. So basically your X is stabilizing the salt that is formed. So it basically forms a salt. There's a positive charge on nitrogen. So to stabilize that positive charge, we have our X, that is our halogen or triplet, whatever group it is, it gets removed. And then we get this particular product over here. Then again, you can see the rearrangement takes place, that is our cis-trans isomerization takes place, and then reductive elimination to get our compound. So this is a copper-free step of this particular reaction. The only difference is over here we are using ligands that can be easily exchanged by our alkyne, okay, instead of using copper. Now coming on to the recent reactions, you can see over here this was reported in 2017 and you don't see a copper reagent over here. So we have a aryl chloride over here. This whole moiety is your quinoline, and then we have a simple alkyne, and you can see there's a carbon-carbon bond formed between the alkyne and the quinoline group where the chlorine was earlier positioned. And the reaction is quite easy to perform, room temperature reaction. We are using palladium triphenylphosphine, tetrakis triphenylphosphine, cesium carbonate is acting as a base over here, and 1,4-dioxane is our solvent, right? Then you can see another synthesis of GRN529. Both utilized your carbon Sonogoshira reaction, but one was more efficient than the other. So if you see this reaction, we have our aryl iodine. This is our aryl iodine, right? So over here the Sonogoshira reaction is going to take place, and then we have this alkyne derivative of pyridine. And if you focus over here, what are we using? We are using a palladium catalyst, that too in very high amount. 20 mol% is a very high amount. We are using a copper catalyst, then trithalamine, and the solvent is toluene, and toluene is a very is a carcinogenic solvent, so we try and avoid toluene. And the temperature is 100 degrees Celsius, and in 6 hours you get the product. Basically you get a Sonogoshira reaction coupled product. But if you do proper optimization means changing different aspects of a reaction so as to get a better performance out of it. So you can see how much improvement we have. We are using, instead of 20 mol% now we are using only 1 mol%, and instead of 20 mol% of copper we are using only 2 mol% of copper. And over here we are using ammonium hydroxide as a base. Instead of trithalamine we are using ammonium hydroxide, and NMP is our solvent. NMP is nothing but N-methyl pyrrolidone. Okay, if I talk about the structure of this compound, NMP, it's basically acting as a solvent, and I'll just draw you the structure. So we have a methyl group attached to the nitrogen, and it's a 5-membered ring, and to this second position we have a double bond O. So it's called N-methyl pyrrolidone. Okay, this is acting as a solvent, and just at room temperature, that is at 35 to 40 degrees Celsius, if I talk about India, it's just the room temperature, and in 1 hour you get excellent yield. Okay, so this is a optimized product. Again, both are Sonogoshira reactions, but you can see by just changing a few things, changing the solvent and changing the base, there's a drastic improvement in the reaction. And it can also be utilized in heterocyclic ring systems to make heterocyclic ring systems. Like over here we have made an indole. This whole ring that is formed, that is a 6-membered benzene ring and a 5-membered nitrogen ring, this is called an indole. Okay, and how do we prepare this? So you can see this is the example I was talking about, that where the Sonogoshira reaction is going to take place. So since I told you aryl iodines are more reactive, so the Sonogoshira reaction will be preferred at the position where iodine is there. So Sonogoshira reaction takes place, cesium carbonate is our base, toluene is the solvent, copper iodide 10 mol% we are using, and palladium 10 mol% we are using. Okay, then after that what we are doing is, after that we are simply, there's a nucleophilic this reaction is taking place. Basically your benzene is going to be formed. Once the benzene is going to be formed, because this is a very good base, it will abstract one hydrogen. Like let's say it abstracts this particular hydrogen over here, and once this hydrogen is abstracted, this bond goes over here, chlorine leaves, and a benzene is generated, right? Benzene is generated, it's a reactive intermediate. Then we get this particular product. Once we get this product, what happens is this nitrogen, what it does, it attacks the triple bond and forms a 5-membered ring. Compared to, it can attack over here also and form a 4-membered ring, but all of you know that a 5-membered ring is both thermodynamically and kinetically favored. So it will form a 5-membered ring, and this will be our final product, that is an indole, which is substituted at the end position and at the second position, right? So these are some of the applications of a Sonogoshira reaction. I hope you found this video useful. If you did, please give me a feedback about the video and also like it and share it with your friends, right? So thank you so much for watching. I hope you are liking the series. and really looking forward to reading your comments. I read them daily, and whenever I get time, I also reply to your comments, right? So thank you so much for watching.